This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas-Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare to you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want to welcome everyone throughout the world to this ministry. Thank God. Thank God. Amen. Thank God. Amen. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 tells what the gospel is. How that Jesus died, bare our sins, according to Scripture. He was buried. He rose again the third day, according to Scripture. Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because God has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering the sight to the blind, set at liberty, and men are bruised. What is neither even in your heart, in your mouth, is the word of faith, which I have preached. You will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. You shall be saved. With the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Thank God. Amen. Amen. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation. Everyone that believeth, the Jew first, and also to the Greek, therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as is written, the just shall live by his faith. Amen. I want to welcome all of you to this broadcast on shortwave, live stream, Roku, or other devices. Kathy Davidson will be preaching the gospel, followed by Terry Brown, ministering just one day at a time. Followed by Terry and the Browns looking for a city. Followed by Terry, the Browns, and Paul Peters, Our God Reigns. Followed by Terry, the Browns, and Paul Peters, Thank God, Alpha and Omega. After they sing, minister the song, I'm going to come back and say hello. Here is Kathy D.
If you would turn with me to Luke 15. I'm going to open with prayer. Father, I thank you. My heavenly Father, I thank you. My heavenly Father, I thank you. Let the power of my Lord be great. Father, let the power of my Lord be great. Open our ears that we can hear. Open our hearts like you did for Lydia, that we can attend unto the things which are spoken. Turn us from darkness to light, from the power of Satan unto God. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Tonight, God is having me minister some exhortation. And I'm speaking to those that are listening to me that are in a mess. A mess. Have you ever been in a mess? Don't put your hands up, but I can put my hands up. Have you ever been in a mess? Have you ever been in trouble? You know, the Psalms say, look out, folks, the trouble's coming. But God will deliver us out of them all. But have you ever been in a real mess? Now, has the mess ever been your fault? Have you ever been in a big mess because of what you've done? I want to minister to us tonight what God thinks about that. If you will turn with me to Luke 15, I'm going to begin in verse 11. A certain man had two sons. The younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. and he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. Wasted his substance, spent all his money. And when you read with riotous living, he didn't spend it in the right places. So this man is in a mess. He's in a big mess. And riotous living, if you go on and you hear what the brother talks about, this brother, and he says he spent his money with harlots. So he also is in that kind of a mess. He's in the mess of fornication. So he is in a big mess. Now look and see how God handles this. Not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent it all, there arose a mighty famine in the land, and he began to be in want. This man is in trouble, and he deserves it. Do you hear me? This man is in trouble, and he deserves it. And he said, and he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And then when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough to eat and spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise, and I will go to my father. Look at what he does here. I will go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee. I have sinned against heaven. He spent all his father's money with riotous living. And it says later he spent it with some harlots. And he said, I've sinned against heaven, and I've sinned against thee. And he said, and I am no more worthy to be called my son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose, and he came to his father. He's in trouble. He goes back to his father in the midst of the trouble. But, I love that word, but. But when he was yet a great way off. Now remember, this trouble is his fault. It didn't happen to him accidentally. It didn't happen to him under circumstances. It is his fault. He is in a big mess. So he goes back to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him, had compassion, and ran to him. He ran to the man who got himself in trouble. And the father fell on his neck and he kissed him. He's in a big heap of trouble. He goes back to his father. And what does his father do? He runs to him. He runs to him. Do you hear me? The father runs to him. Are you in a big mess? Run to your heavenly father. He says, his father saw him and had compassion, ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Do you think the father knew at this point what had happened to the boy? And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For my son was dead, but is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. The father here is happy. Now, who is Jesus describing in this? He's describing the heavenly father. He's describing your heavenly father. You are in a big mess, and you see no way to get out of it, and you might have put yourself in it. What does the father do when you go to him? He runs to you. He runs to you. To you. But you don't know what I've done. He runs to you. but you don't know how big of a mess I'm in. He runs to you. Do you hear that? You know what? This is no time to be self-righteous. This is no time to be a self-righteous person. If you read a little bit on here, we'll find out about the self-righteous. And for my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. The father's happy. He's happy. Now the elder son was in the field. And as he came and drew nigh to the house, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, thy brother is come. And thy father has killed the fatted calf because he has received him safe and sound. Run to your heavenly father. And he was angry. He was angry. And he would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And answering, he said to his father, lo, these many years did I serve thee, neither transgress I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gave me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. This is no time to be self-righteous. No time. Self-righteous gets nothing. Okay, and he said, yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which has devoured thy living with harlots. Devoured thy living with harlots. So not only did he spend his money, now he's in fornication. Thou hast killed for him the fatted calf. And he said unto him, son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet, it was necessary that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again and was lost and is found. This is the Heavenly Father's attitude. If you find yourself in a big mess, he says, run to him. Go back home. I'm speaking to somebody. Go home, and your Heavenly Father will meet you there. Amen. He will meet you. I want us to turn to Luke 1. I want to show you a verse. I'm going to begin in verse 35. And the angel answered and said unto her, Mary, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called the Son of God. And behold, thy cousin Elizabeth, she has conceived a son in her old age. And with this is the sixth month with her who is called barren. Look at this next verse. For with God nothing, nothing is impossible. Do you believe the Bible? Do you believe the Bible? Nothing. Nothing is impossible. If you have to tell yourself that 5,000 times a day to get out of your mess, you tell yourself that 5,000 times a day because it will work. Nothing is impossible with God. You know who's talking to you? Somebody that was in a huge mess. Somebody that was in a huge mess. And I had to take some responsibility for it. And you know what? God took an absolutely impossible situation. Absolutely impossible. And he turned it completely around. And I got out, frankly, smelling like a rose. I got out. You know, there was a situation. I had to sell a house. And I was looking forward to selling the house because I thought with the profit I could take care of some of the debts that I saw I had. And I tried, I worked with an apostle and a prophet. I have to say this right now, an apostle and prophet was sent to me and he got me out with the Father leading him. He showed me how to get out. You say you don't need a prophet and apostle, but why then does the word say that you need one? Can you read? It says that when your obedience is fulfilled, then God will help you. Do you know what? That apostle, that prophet told me, sell the house. So I went to go sell the house. You know, I was so happy to get rid of the house, and I knew that it needed to be sold. that I even tried to sell it to a woman that absolutely needed the house. Well, she needed a house, and she couldn't afford the one I had. So I was going to forego all my profit I was going to make on the house just so she could have the house. I was going to forego all my profit. You know what? God wouldn't let me. Thank God he wouldn't let me. Because once we got the house, a buyer for the house, I found out I owed more than the house was worth in liens. Now, there is an impossible situation. I have no money. I have to sell a house. The profit, I'm not going to see any profit on the house. In fact, I'm going to owe more than what I can sell the house for. I call that an impossible situation. So God sends me a buyer. It was a Navy corpsman. What a surprise. It was a Navy corpsman. And the house needed a lot of fixing up. It needed a lot of fixing up. I didn't have the money to fix it up. I had to sell it as is. And you know what? That God had that buyer come to me, and he said, I want to buy the house. And this is exactly what he told me. This is the power of God working through an apostle and prophet to a woman that's in a huge mess. This buyer said, I see that the house needs a lot of work, but I am going to buy the house at full price from you. And then I'm going to get a loan and I'm going to fix it on my own. I said, well, don't you want me to get you a reduced rate for the house so you can buy it? He told me no. He refused to take less money. And you think God cannot do the impossible? He refused to take less money. He said, I'm going to buy this house at full price. And you know what he did? He did. That was the first miracle. Then we go into the buyers. And I find out I've got all these liens, and a bunch of them are in my name that I didn't even know were there. I didn't even know they existed. And they're in my name. And I got the IRS after me, and I got all this after me. I mean, you talk about a big mess. You talk about a huge mess. And what does this say? Go to the Father. There is nothing impossible with God. Can you hear me? There is nothing, nothing impossible with God. This is the God that split the Red Sea to get, they think about 2 million people out. Do you think he can get you out of your mess? Yes. With God, nothing is impossible. Do you know that God had that title company? God did it. They made a mistake, a big mistake. They made a huge mistake in my favor, in my favor. And when it was found out, weeks later, they came back to me and they couldn't change it. They couldn't change it. That was made in my favor. I mean, we're talking tens of thousands of dollars, the mistake they made on my behalf. Now, who do you think did that? With God, nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. How can God do that? Turn with me to Isaiah 53. I will show you how God can do that. How could God help somebody in that kind of a mess? And he did. It says, verse 6, all we like sheep have gone astray. All we like sheep. There's that word all again. All. All. There are no exclusions in all. So we've all, like sheep, have gone astray. You know, if you read that right, we've all been in a mess. We've all been in a mess. We have all, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And look at this. And the Lord laid on Jesus the iniquity of us all. How could I get out? Jesus took the iniquity. Jesus took what I did and what was done that put me in such a big mess. He took it on his own body, and he was happy to do so. He was happy to do so. You need out of your mess, you go to Jesus. I want to show you one more verse. Psalm 147. You run to your heavenly Father. You run to Jesus. And you bring the gospel with you when you go. Verse 11. The Lord taketh pleasure. Can you believe this verse? I'm going to start in verse 10. He delighteth not in the strength of a horse. Sorry, Doyle. He taketh not pleasure in the legs of a man. Amen. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that fear him. In them that fear him. And look at this next part. In those that hope in his mercy. In those that hope in his mercy. In those that hope in his mercy. And where did he show his mercy? In the death of Jesus on the crucifixion. When he put your iniquity and my iniquity on Jesus. The very thing that got you in the mess that you're in now was put on the body of Jesus for you. For you. And he took it. Happily took it. And then he was buried. And then he was raised again for you. The Father saw the travail of that iniquity, paying for it. And he was satisfied. And he raised Jesus from the dead for you. For you to get out of that mess. I am telling you, run to the Father with your mess. And bring the gospel with you and watch God do miracle after miracle and get you out. Amen.
I'm only human. I'm just a woman. Help me believe in what I can be and all that I am. Show me the stairway.
Yesterday's gone, sweet.
Just give me the strength to do every day what you have me do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. Help me today, show me the way one day at a time. Lord, help me today, show me your way, one day at a
shadows,
living in
a lonely land
with strangers,
we're a band of pilgrims on the move,
with dangers
burdened down with sorrows,
and we're shunned
on every hand,
but we are
looking for a city built above.
Oh yes, we're
looking for a city,
for a city yonder
where
Savior's love
and mercy,
though we may be strangers
living
in this world of care,
we're always
looking for a city built above.
Oh yes, we're
looking for a city,
looking for a city
yonder
where
we will
never say goodbye.
Say goodbye,
no, never.
voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. He shall dwell within them, they shall be his people, and Almighty God will be with them.
Song power worldwide. See, the word, the pneumas, it's a power. It's the power of God. Kathy D been with me, she moved in with me about 6.5 years ago, the Lord. And she knew I was a veterinarian. I trained a lot of horses. And she was a horse enthusiast from way as a child. Always liked horses. So between me preaching the gospel, casting devils out of her, ministering to her, we talked about horses. And she had all kinds of good questions. And she would talk to me about horses and their strength. To the Bible, God speaks of it. Well, it just so happened, I was pretty well schooled in the horse industry and treated a lot of lame horses, leg problems. And they actually are a phenomenal creature to the human race. Amazing. Their little bones, their little feet, their tendons, their ligaments, their muscles just amaze academic people. Years ago, a bunch of academia decided they would do a bunch of studies and calculations on a horse. And when they got through with their studies, they said, horses, it's impossible for them to carry the weight on their leg structure. Oh, really? Really? What a laugh. What a laugh. No, they said, it's impossible. There's not enough bone. There's not enough tendons. There's not enough ligaments. Not enough muscle. There's just not enough to hold up that horse going down that track, striding 21, 23, maybe 25, 27 feet, and stride and land, and they just keep on going. Oh, it's fun. I was one of them. It's fun to find out. God made a horse, and you know what he said? He even talks about the strength of her legs. Well, I guess I lost this ground. Well, I'm not going to lose you now. Jesus Christ died for our sins. He was buried. He rose again the third day according to the scripture. That happens to be the power of God. The power of God. Now, you people that quote from the book of Romans, only one verse that I remember that talks about the power of the Holy Ghost. I can't say it like Catherine Kuhlman could. My friends, the Holy Ghost has no power. The Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit, gets its power from the gospel, the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Acts 10:38 says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power, who went around doing good and healing all that were oppressed of the devil. Now, I'm going to shake you up. You see, I've been in the charismatic movement since 1970, 45 plus years. I've listened. You people talk. And oh, is it beautiful. Holy Ghost, take over my tongue. Take over my lips. Take over my mouth. And speak God's people. That's an empty prayer. Holy Ghost cannot do one thing. It's the Father that ministers the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. Oh, yes, through his servants, Jesus. Can you get Ephesians 1? Get ready. When I first got in the charismatic movement, I've always been a person that wanted to know why. My professors, University of Missouri, some of them didn't like me. They said, oh, you always want to know why. And of course. I never said it, but I thought, well, that's what you're getting paid for. Why don't you tell me why? You know why? Because they couldn't. All they knew was knowledge. And I got into the charismatic church, and they would say, I'm waiting on God. You are? I want to know. What were they waiting on? And how they knew they were waiting on him. So I said, I'd ask people, and say, I'd say, what are you doing? Waiting on God. You are? Yeah. What are you waiting for? I don't know. Well, did he tell you to wait? No. Well, you know you're waiting on it. Well, I don't know. Well, I never did say it, but I do today. Why'd you lie to us? I was in an automobile with four men in Fort Lauderdale, Hollywood, actually, Florida, one night. And they were real gospel men. And they were talking about what God had done, what God was saying to them. Well, I was excited that God was talking to them. Boy, they were just chattering. Sound like a bunch of people on, what do you call them, cell phones. And I said, you know, that's great. I wish God would talk to me. All he did was told me to come to Florida. They said, oh, we don't mean he's talking to us. I said, you don't? Why do you say he did? Why do you say what he says to you? You know what? They were lying. Doyle, not nice to say Holy Ghost filled people lie. Well, I know it's not, but it's not nice to lie. All liars go to the pit. So after a couple, 3 years, God knew I was a frustrated veterinarian. And he knew if it wouldn't work, I didn't want any part of it. So one day the Lord said to me, the church is not waiting on me. I said, they're not? No. What are they waiting on? They're not waiting on me, the Lord said. I said, well, what are they waiting on? I'm waiting on them. Well, what are you waiting on the church for? What? Who am I talking to? There's the church says they're waiting on God, and there's this voice somewhere up here saying, well, I'm waiting on them. I thought, could this be God talking to me? See, I hadn't been to seminary. I had not been to Bible school. I had my own. God gave it to me. But not yet, though. I have not sat at the feet of the great preachers of America and the world. No. I have not. I'd been taught by Jesus riding in my car, sitting under shade trees, sitting in my house, praying. Incredible. The Lord said, turn to Ephesians 1, isn't it?
That is right.
What?
Ephesians 1.
Look, I'm in reverse. And my tail lights are out. Okay. Let's go. He said, turn to, is it Ephesians 1?
Ephesians 1.
Verse what, 11?
I can begin there.
No, well.
I think it's 17.
Well, that's a good place to begin.
That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe.
Oh, he said, whoa. You mean God says, whoa? Yeah, he knows how to drive a horse. Well, you say, whoa to a horse. Whoa. Stop. He said, that's what I'm waiting on the church for. That's what I'm waiting for the church to do. And that is to believe. Believe that the power that I, Jehovah, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, I am, work in Jesus when he raised him from the dead. KD, did I say that right?
That is right.
Who raised Jesus from the dead?
The Father.
Oh, and he worked it through the Holy Ghost.
Right, according to the working of his mighty power, the Father's, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places.
You see, the Father works the Holy Spirit, through the Holy Spirit. Do you know that? Do you know God raised Jesus from the dead? Do you know I was really troubled listening to all these people that thought they were somebody telling me how great they were. And I was so confused because God told me to sell my veterinary practice. Oh, I wasn't waiting on him to tell me. I was just driving down the highway and he said, sell it. I didn't want to. That day changed my life. Now, if you will take those scriptures and look at them and meditate, read them, God will show you that he will work that same, does that say power?
It said, let's see, the exceeding greatness of his power to usward who believe.
Power.
According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ.
Somebody look up and see if that word power is not dunamis. I don't think it's exousia, but I wasn't prepared because I haven't been able to see the Bible for more than 6 years because of the devil working through God's people. In my vision, but it's coming back, folks.
Amen.
Get it straight.
The first use of power is dunamis. The second is a different word.
It is dunamis?
The first time it says it in that verse.
Right. The second one's it's an authority?
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway,
yeah.
He worked his power in Jesus when he raised him from the dead. I said, you raised Jesus from the dead? Well, how do you think he got raised? And what's incredible, I say, you being Jehovah, what's incredible, he said, I'll work that power in you if you believe. Does that say that, Katie?
Yes, it does.
It does?
What is exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe.
Which he worked in Christ.
According to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ, when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places.
My goodness, I was stunned. I'd been to Bible school, had been to seminary. I did not know any preachers very well. And I said to the Father, you've got to take her. From this day on, I will believe that you, Jehovah, actually, he hadn't revealed himself to me as Jehovah at that time. But I knew him as I am, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But he said, I will work that in you if you believe. And I said, you've got to take her. And from that day forward, Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for working that power, that gospel in me, that you work in Jesus when you raise him from the dead. Oh, does he like to hear that? You know, I've got to say something. Philip said to Jesus, show us the Father. Well, Jesus said, if you have seen me, Jesus, you've seen the Father. That's an amazing scripture. Did you say two? Amazing scripture. Jesus was express image, it says in Hebrews, of the Father. The Father, if you've seen Jesus, you've seen the Father. Understand, folks, God is not 9 million miles tall. Understand the power of the gospel. The power of the gospel. And it's available to you and I. If we believe, God will work that power in us, for us, through us, to profit us, benefit us. I want to encourage you, believe the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. That's all you have to do. Believe it, walk in it, make faith with it. And God will work that power in you that he raised, worked in Jesus when he raised him from the dead. My friends, you don't know. You don't know what's in us. Let me give you a clue. All the power you'll ever want. And God works it. Just keep it up. Don't quit. Keep praying. Keep thanking God. Keep obeying God. Do his will. Get the mind of Christ. Do what he tells you. Obey him. You'll do well. Thank God. Good night. See you.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas, 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.